are coming down to the 16th bowl. Catholic Boy is pulling away. He's so impressive today, the others didn't even have a prayer. Catholic Boy rolls in the run. Happy Travers.
Live from the backstretch at historic Saratoga Race Course, this is Racing Across America with Seth Merrow. Race the Leah Auto Group. To search their inventory, schedule a service appointment, or find a dealership near you, visit leahcars.com. Leah Cars for life.
Good morning and welcome to the Friday edition of Racing Across America. I'm Seth Merrow. The day before, and I thought the day before the Travers, we would try to keep some semblance of normalcy. And normally we have Randy Moss sitting next to us here with the NBC coverage. NBC not in town this year for the Travers, but obviously 4 weeks down the road, they will cover the Kentucky Derby. So I thought we'd reach out to Randy and talk a little Travers, three-year-olds in general, Kentucky Derby and whatnot. And again, as I say, normally sitting here next to us, but in pandemic 2020 via Zoom. Randy, good morning.
Hey, good morning, Seth. Nice to be with you, whether it's Zoom or sitting next to you. I've gotten pretty good at this Zoom thing, I think.
You and everybody else, absolutely. It's been the way to go over the past couple of months or so. Speaking of that, we had talked to you just before the Belmont Stakes, and at that point, the racing world was just kind of coming back into the game after the period where the five major tracks were going during the quarantine period. And now pretty much everybody who's supposed to be up and running is up and running. And looking the last couple of weeks at baseball and at the NBA, frankly, I think horse racing has done itself proud. I think given the whole situation, I think racing has chugged along in a great way. And as I say, compared to what we've seen from the major league sports that have had their hiccups over the past couple of weeks, I'm patting ourselves on the back.
Oh, I think so too, Seth. I mean, there were obviously some issues in California with jockeys that tested positive for COVID-19 and things like that. But as I think we discussed earlier before the Belmont, I mean, horse racing has been uniquely positioned through this whole thing to be one of the few, if not the only sport that could thrive simply because it already had a very robust off-track betting component to it, even, you know, during normal times. And I think we've seen that the handle numbers have skyrocketed at racetracks across the country simply because it's been the only game in town, and not just other sports that have had to close down, but casinos as well. The casino gambling competition has been much less for horse racing during this whole pandemic than it used to be. So, I mean, there's not many silver linings in this whole COVID-19 thing, but for horse racing, at least they've been able to proceed with at least some sense of normalcy without fans.
Yeah, and obviously extra precaution, certainly up here at Saratoga, I've talked about it quite a bit. No fans, they've allowed owners, but as we come in every day, temperature checks and whatnot, you have to wear the mask around the facility. And, you know, the understandable and commendable at this time precautions, but we've gone on, we've had some great racing up here, and tomorrow, you know, who would have thought a week and a day into August we'd be talking about the Travers, but obviously it had to change this year because of the rescheduled Kentucky Derby to put it in a position where horses could move from the Travers to the Kentucky Derby. But again, we typically will have you on before the Travers a little bit later, but we'll talk Travers this year given the scenario. And I have some video, Tis the Law's workout last Saturday. We'll take a look at that. We also have the stretch run, Uncle Chuck and the Los Al Derby. And it seems like those two are getting the concentration for tomorrow. There are some others that are interesting. The top two finishers out of the Peter Pan, Max Player for Linda Rice out of the third in the Belmont. But I'd love your thoughts on tomorrow's Travers. And Tis the Law, to me, with the resume, I think is clearly at the top of the class. And with his experience, I'm tilting in that direction. What are your thoughts on the Travers?
Well, Seth, I think they're the two best three-year-olds in the country, Tis the Law and Uncle Chuck. I'm a big fan of Tis the Law. I have been since March. But I also loved with an exclamation point, Uncle Chuck's race in the Los Al Derby from every possible perspective. I loved it from a final time perspective. I loved it from a visual perspective. And I think that Uncle Chuck is and will be a formidable opponent for Tis the Law on Saturday, and I wouldn't be surprised in the least to see him beat Tis the Law. it, you know, I mean, yes, the Travers has repositioned itself as it needed to, as a, I don't want to call it a prep for the Kentucky Derby, because the Travers is such an important race in its own right. It's not a prep for anything, but it's certainly a stepping stone that horsemen are using to get to the Kentucky Derby. And they're fortunate, I think, to have the two best three-year-olds in the country. You can say a lot about Art Collector, who's up and coming, who's running Sunday in the Ellis Park Derby. But these two, I think Naira is fortunate to have. And I think right now, they've separated themselves from the rest of the three-year-olds.
Yeah, and again, we're just watching the end of the workout for Tis the Law last Saturday, and clearly he has taken to the surface, which, again, I mentioned earlier on the handicapping show. He won over this track last year, but there's not necessarily that same horse-for-course angle, given that the track was redone before the meet this year. So it's a new surface, essentially. But he's worked over it. He's clearly taken to the surface. We're going to take a look at that stretch run of the Los Al as well, because a lot of people like you are looking at that and saying, Uncle Chuck is a potential monster. But let me ask you this. If it was anybody but Bob Baffert with only the two starts, would you be as high on this horse coming into a race like the Travers?
I mean, the Baffert component obviously plays a role, and it's something that you can't ignore because of Bob's past record and his ability to get three-year-olds, even now in the second half of the year, to get to certain races at their peak, and his ability to develop three-year-olds. So, I mean, yeah, that's part of the equation, but it should be part of the equation. But even if it weren't Baffert, Seth, I mean, when you look at visually the way that he ran in the Los Al Derby, okay, which was long striding, very visually impressive, mile and an eighth and 147 and change, I think it's even a better race than the figure makers give it credit for. And then you fast forward to the horse that he beat in the Los Al Derby, Thousand Words, coming back in his next start in the Shared Belief at Del Mar and outrunning Honor AP, who was widely considered to be the number 2 3-year-old in the country going into that race behind Tis the Law. And, I mean, Uncle Chuck not only beat Thousand Words, he completely blew him away. So that's why I think Uncle Chuck will be a formidable opponent for Tis the Law, and it'll be interesting to see what happens. You know what? What's funny? I was just talking about this the other day with a good friend of mine and a horse player. Horse racing is so unique from any other sport in that we try to analyze these horses, and we try to project what's going to happen, let's say, especially with these three-year-olds in a race like the Travers, on less information than any other sport in America. I mean, you're looking at two races lifetime for Uncle Chuck. Imagine trying to analyze an NFL player on the basis of two games only in his career. You know, I mean, it would never, ever happen. And when you think back on the way things work like this in horse racing, the narrative changes month to month to month. And it's not uncommon when you're going into a normal Kentucky Derby first Saturday in May, right? You can get guys like me and guys like you. First of February, we're talking about where the three-year-olds stand right now, and we can be very firm based on what we've seen so far. These are the best three-year-olds. And then we get to the first of March, and the narrative can completely change. Now it's this horse who's emerged as the best three-year-old. And then you get to the first of April, and it completely changes again, right? So right now, the narrative going into the Travers, this is what I'm trying to get at, is that Tis the Law, after that Belmont Stakes win, is head and shoulders the best three-year-old in America. But it's entirely possible that coming out of the Travers, the narrative is going to do a 180, and Uncle Chuck might go to the Kentucky Derby, regarded as head and shoulders the best three-year-old in America. We'll see.
Yeah, and this, you know, speaking of the Kentucky Derby, the first Saturday in May, and the way we all come into that race, this Travers almost has a feel like that, because it is the first time, mile and a quarter for these horses, given the scenario this year. We do have some lightly raced horses like Uncle Chuck, and there used to be, you'd get to the Derby, and yeah, you would have less information than you wanted, but it used to be that you had some historical precedents you could kind of rely on. But over the last 10 years, a lot of those have completely disappeared. So there is a little bit of a crystal ball factor at work. You mentioned Honor AP, and I'm just curious, what are your thoughts after the defeat If people were on the Honor AP wagon, jump off, or is it one of those you can't make a decision really definitively one way or the other on one race?
Well, you know, watching the race as it happened live, I came away with the general impression that Honor AP didn't run his race, right? He didn't run as well as he had run in the Santa Anita Derby for whatever reason, and that's okay. Horses don't always run their best races, and he'll probably take to the mile and a quarter in the Kentucky Derby, and he'll be just fine and probably rebound. But then you look at it from a speed figure perspective. I don't want to get too inside baseball here, but I know your viewers are very savvy. When you make speed figures for that day, for the shared belief at Del Mar, there were only two races that day run around two turns. The other race, which happened a couple of races after the shared belief, was a one-mile race for very consistent allowance horses that had a very well-established form, and it was a very predictable running time and a very predictable figure. And based on that race, which you have to go on because it was a fast track and the track didn't really seem to change throughout the day, suddenly the speed figure for the shared belief comes up much higher than anyone expected. It comes up to be a 104 buyer speed figure, which basically tells you that Honor AP ran pretty much the same race that he ran in the Santa Anita Derby and just got beat. He got beat by a horse in Thousand Words who controlled the pace, and it was a very speed and rail favoring racetrack, I think, that day at Del Mar, so that didn't help Honor AP. But I tend to think that his race was better in hindsight than I did watching it live to begin with.
Give us some thoughts also on another possible contender, Authentic in the Haskell. I think a lot of people, given what wound up to be a top of the stretch, it looked like he had it in the bag and turned out to be kind of a dogfight down the lane. So I think now a lot of people question maybe Authentic in the mile and a quarter.
Yeah, I don't like him at all at a mile and a quarter. And I think I made that clear to anyone who was watching the telecast that we did on NBC of that race. I mean, you talk about a horse that had everything his own way during the running of the Haskell on a speed-favoring racetrack. It looked like he had just completely put away New York traffic at the top of the stretch and even in mid-stretch. And then he was desperate to hold on as New York traffic came back at him. I mean, I know there's – yeah. I don't buy the argument that he was jumping shadows on the backstretch. You can watch the head on. You don't see any of that. I mean, I don't buy the argument that he was distracted and looking around down the stretch. He was looking all right. He was looking for the finish line is what he was looking for. So at a mile and a quarter now, in a race that should have a robust early pace with, I mean, Baffert's other horse in there, Thousand Words, and there's going to be some other speed in there as well for sure. There always is in the Derby. Now, I don't like him at all at a mile. I think he's a nice horse. I'd love to own him. At a mile and a 16th against the right field, a mile and an eighth, but I can't like him at all at a mile and a quarter.
And let's talk about another one you mentioned a little bit earlier, because the Ellis Park Derby goes on Sunday and Art Collector is back in there. And Art Collector seems like maybe he's just come back as an improved three-year-old. I mean, the past couple of starts, that certainly seems to jump off the page. The optional claimer at Churchill, and then the bluegrass win. We'll take a look at that bluegrass win where he beats the filly Swiss Skydiver. Art Collector will be the number three horse here as you watch him come down the stretch. But should he come out of the Ellis Park Derby with a big win, what are his chances headed to the Derby?
I think right now I would put him right there with Honor AP, right, in the number three or number four spot behind, in my opinion, Tis the Law and Uncle Chuck. Art Collector, he had a really good race at Churchill Downs as a two-year-old on one of those. It might have been even on Kentucky Jockey Club Day on the undercard. But then his last few races, he's really taken it to the next level, especially his last couple. From a numbers perspective, from a visual perspective, I mean, he shouldn't have any problem with a mile and a quarter. He's going into the race in the right direction. He's shown he can that he likes Churchill Downs, or he can handle it okay. I think he's a formidable horse, and he's one of these horses that we talked about way back when the Derby rescheduled to September. We knew then that there were going to be some horses like Uncle Chuck who were going to be in a good position for a Labor Day weekend Kentucky Derby that probably wouldn't have been in that spot on the first Saturday in May. And I think, yeah, Art Collector is one of those kinds.
Yeah, it's going to be interesting to see what he does on Sunday. Again, the Ellis Park Derby coming up this weekend as well. Well, I'm going to pin you down a little bit. We talked to Isla, we talked to Uncle Chuck. If you have to make a decision in the Travers, which way are you going to tilt?
If the line is accurate, and what I think Tis the Law is 4-5, even money. What is he on the line?
We're looking even money on Tis the Law. We're looking 5-2 on Uncle Chuck.
Okay, at that price, I would take Uncle Chuck.
Okay.
At five to two, I don't think there is as much between the two horses based on Uncle Chuck's win in the Los Al Derby as that line and as the probable betting in the race would indicate. I know Tis the Law is much more seasoned. I have great respect for Tis the Law. If you're just picking and you're not betting, then I might give Tis the Law a slight advantage based on seasoning and based on what we've seen. I mean, he's a tremendously tactical horse. He can be close to the pace. He can be a little further back from the pace. He's got great turn of foot, nice acceleration when needed. He checks all the boxes. But from a betting perspective, if there's that much of a difference between the two prices, give me Uncle Chuck.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a lot of fun and going to look for a nice battle down the stretch. I have to root for Tis the Law, you know, kind of the hometown story as well, and Saratoga and Jack Knowlton, Barkley Tag, and Robin Smullins and company. And again, I just give him the experience edge. I think if this was the Derby with that experience as compared to Uncle Chuck, people would be a little more on the Tis the Law bandwagon, but it's going to be fun to see. Let's talk a little Derby now just before we let you go. A couple of questions, because again, NBC will have the coverage coming up in about 4 weeks. What's your take on, and I think this will present another, you know, little part of the handicapping puzzle going into the Derby this year, the announcement a couple of days ago that Churchill is going to require the jockeys to be there really a couple weeks early, which I think is going to, you would have to think there are going to be some jockeys that maybe are going to say, particularly up here at Saratoga with a couple of grade ones in that 2 week period, will say, you know what, I'm going to stick where I am. So I think some of the regular jockeys will be switched up on these horses.
Maybe. And you know, you can ask Jerry Bailey what I think about that. I don't care in the least. I'm always digging Jerry about the over-exaggerator, over-exaggeration, yeah, of the importance of jockeys when you get to the top level. Now, I know if you were to take, you know, Irad Ortiz or Jose Ortiz or John Velasquez and you were to put them at a B-level racetrack, they would absolutely dominate and they would be a huge handicapping factor. But in my opinion, Seth, when you get to the very top level, when you get to the top 15, 20, 25 jockeys in America, you know, you give any of them the best horse in a race, and I don't think you would see, you know, a great deal of difference. So I don't pay too much attention to, where I do pay attention to riders is when they apparently, and it's not always the case if you see it on paper, but when they apparently have a choice between horse A, horse B, maybe even horse C, and then they choose to ride a certain horse. I mean, you have to take the stable into account because, you know, some jockeys, rightly so, give extra credit to a Chad Brown or a Todd Fletcher or somebody like that. But, you know, when it appears that a jockey, especially for a race like the Derby, has ridden both horses and has picked horse A over horse B, then I'll pay a lot of attention to it. But otherwise, not really.
Let me hit on one more question because this has kind of been an interesting debate I've had with people over the past couple of weeks. Do you think there's going to be 20 in the Derby this year?
I've gone back and forth on that.
Yeah.
I was debating people earlier in the year that there probably wouldn't be 20 horses by the time we got to the first Saturday in September. And then I kind of thought there would be because, you know, all these horses pop out of the woodwork. But, you know, the more I think about it, I kind of don't think there will be 20, Seth. I think it'll be a big field. You know, I think it'll be 17, 18 in the Derby. But we've seen a lot of pretenders, horses that turned out to be pretenders that have fallen by the wayside that probably would have been in a first Saturday in May Kentucky Derby, but now have shown that they don't belong. And I think another factor in this whole thing is that I think to a certain extent, owners enjoy and always want to be a part of the Derby Day experience.
Yeah.
The Derby weekend experience at Churchill Downs, right? And obviously, because of the pandemic, that is just not going to be the same. and it costs a lot of money to run a horse in the Kentucky Derby, and hotel rooms probably won't cost as much this year as they normally do. But it's not a cheap thing, and I just think there may not be the same Derby fever for owners this year with marginal horses as we might have seen in the past.
Yeah, I think I'm in the same camp as you are. I don't think it'll be 20, but I think it'll be a bigger than normal, you know, on a normal day field of, you know, 15, 16, something like that, which still offers some nice betting options. And it's going to play out well for my all others bet in one of the early future. I looked the other day. I think the future pool I played the all others in, there's like three horses remaining. So that may work out very well. The pandemic may have one bonus for me betting wise. Randy, as always, appreciate the visit, the conversation. As they say, a little sense of normalcy to have you in here talking the day before the Travers. And we'll probably check in again before the Derby this year in your NBC coverage.
All right. Glad to be sitting next to you on Zoom, Seth. Take care. Have a good Travers.
Thanks. Randy Moss from NBC Sports. We will take a break. When we come back, Racing Across America continues with more Travers conversation. Stay tuned. No track, no problem. There's no better place to follow the Saratoga race meet than Capital OTB and OTB TV. With our live TV shows from the Saratoga Backstretch and our live remotes, all the information you need is right here. Each and every day of the Saratoga meet, we talk with all the top trainers, jockeys, handicappers, and racing personalities. So stay with Capital OTB and OTB TV this racing season and win more.
I got it. Watch me. I got it. Hey! I got something that makes me want to shout. I got something that tells me what it's all about. I got a move that tells me what to do. If you don't, brothers and sisters, then you won't know what it's all about.
Welcome back to Racing Across America on this Friday morning. As I said all morning long, the day before Travers Day, August 8th. Who would have thought a week and a day into the month of August we'd be talking Travers? But that's the way it is this year. And I thought I'd also reach out to our friend Ellis Starr, the national racing analyst at Equibase, to talk a little Travers, some of the other stakes action. Ellis also took a look for a webinar last night at the Ellis Park Derby coming up on Sunday. So I thought we'd touch on that as well. Ellis, good morning.
Good morning. Good morning, Seth. Glad to be on with everybody. And as I said off air, glad to be on with my face and not my usual just image, my headshot.
We're right in the 21st century here, 2020 pandemic Zoom. You got to love it.
Yeah.
And speaking of that, we haven't talked to you in a while. How are things going? And I mentioned I had Randy Moss on earlier. I don't think we've really talked to you since racing has really got revved up again. But I thought, and as compared to the last couple of weeks looking at some of the other major league sports, I'm giving racing a pat on the back. I think we've been doing all right.
I think we're doing good. I think the economic indicators came out yesterday or today. I think we're at 90 or 95% of handle for the year. The quarter's been fantastic. People are betting. Sports bettors are betting racing. Racing bettors are betting racing. The live experience, of course, is missing. But doing good. And, Saratoga's running and Del Mar's running. So it feels almost normal, except for the Derby is next month.
Yeah, there are some certainly strange aspects to it, but I think there is a sense of normalcy as things have gotten back into play. Let me ask you, is that the webinar you did last night, is there a replay available, or was that streamed live?
No, that was actually, we're not doing them live right now just to make sure everything's good. We taped them. And we put them out right away, so it should be available. Anybody that signed up should have gotten a link. If not, I believe it's at Equibase.com, or someone could send an email to feedback@Equibase.com, and they'll send you a link to the webinar. So it's available all day today. It's basically on demand.
Very good. Stats Race Lens, looking at the races through that as well and whatnot, so people can check that out. And let's move right into the Travers and get some of your thoughts. We've talked about it the past couple of days, so we've looked at the Belmont with Tiz de Law. We've looked at Tiz de Law's nice workout over the track last Saturday. We looked at the Los Al Derby with Uncle Chuck. So I thought while we talked here, we'd pull up the Peter Pan from earlier in the meet. Country Grammar, the number 2, Caracaro, the number 7. They'll have a ding-dong battle, and I think they're a couple of contenders as well. Max Player would be the other one I would throw into the mix. But I'm going to go with the home team. I'm going to go with Tiz de Law. I just think on the experience, he has the edge. But certainly Uncle Chuck makes it very interesting, as do these two coming out of the Peter Pan. But give us your thoughts on the Travers tomorrow.
Well, I think that the key to the race, of course, it's a great race. We need to watch it. Everybody should watch it because it has Derby implications. We want to see if Tiz de Law can hold his form. I think the key to the race is betting structure. I think that Tiz de Law is the one to beat. Last time he went to the Belmont with what we call double advantage, which is the highest 2 speed figures, whether you want to use Equibase or Buyer in the race. Now he's got the best 3. No horse is even closer to his lowest of his 3, which is the Florida Derby. And he's taken these short breaks well. He's run well off these short breaks. He's got tactical speed. I think the interesting thing is I think Uncle Chuck goes, and I think Tiz de Law stalks. And on the webinar last night, we talked about this. Christina Blacker really thinks Uncle Chuck is going to be there at the end. I don't think so. I'm taking an absolute contrary position on Uncle Chuck. I don't think that a horse with 2 races going a mile, mile and 1/8, mile and a quarter against a field of 8. Now, granted, that's not big, but he's been facing 4 and 5 horse fields, even though 1,000 Words did come back to win the race last week. I think Uncle Chuck is maybe in deep water here. And, I'm not a Baffert hater, but this is regarding just the race, the way the race shakes out. If Tiz de Law cracks him, I think he's vulnerable even for second here. So I think the 2 horses out of the Peter Pan, as you mentioned, are good. And I give slight preface to Caracaro, and I respect David Aragona makes the line, but 10-1 on Caracaro versus 6-1 on Country Grammar when they were beaten the neck, considering that Caracaro was coming back from a January to July layoff, yeah, and Country Grammar was making his 3rd start off a layoff, Caracaro's got more upside today or tomorrow in the Travers. And so I like Caracaro better, and I'm going to play it pretty simple. I'm going to play Tiz de Law over Caracaro and Country Grammar over everybody, and then maybe put them in 3rd as well. I do have some other plays on one of my blogs that people can find, Ellis Starr's blogs, everywhere, hopefully, or be follow me on Twitter. So I don't want to go into too much detail on those. But I think those are the two horses to get in there. Chivalry could hang on for a piece. Uncle Chuck could, but I hope he doesn't. But I think it's his law's race to lose. I'm not going to bet him at 3-5. But I think the value is in this trifecta, using those two horses in second and third with everybody in the middle, hopefully getting a price horse and not Uncle Chuck in there.
And I'm assuming Travers is this week's feature race on Equibase?
Yeah, it's our Equibase weekly feature race. But I also covered it with betting recommendations on one of the blogs, because on the Equibase one, we don't do betting recommendations, just do our 1-2-3s.
Very good. All right, let's move on, because there's some other nice stakes tomorrow on the card, nice grade ones as well. One of those is the Ballerina, 7 furlongs for the fillies and mares. I'm going to use Serengeti Empress. And you know, I'm sure there are people who are looking at the last couple of races and aren't sure what to do with Serengeti Empress. But, boy, you go back to that Azari, and I pulled up for us to look at the test from last year right up here at Saratoga. Now, if she finishes second to Covfefe, however, Covfefe will be the number 3, Serengeti Empress the number 1. And I looked at that effort, which may be her best effort of her life, running second, although the Azari this year was pretty good. And I also look at the Bullet Workout coming into this. And so I'm going to tilt towards Serengeti Empress. As I say, off the last two races, I may be up against it a little bit, but the Bullet Workout pulled me in that direction, again, along with his performance in the test last year. What are your thoughts on the Ballerina?
Well, we're going to be polar opposites here.
Okay.
I don't think Serengeti Empress gets away from Latruska. Latruska's been running 1-turn mile at Gulfstream and Oaklawn. She's running 44s, 46s. Serengeti Empress, absolutely, she's only won when she's had the lead from the start. I don't think she gets away from her. If they both run, did both run, this whole analysis is out the window. It's very interesting here. I usually look at Stats Race Lens pace analysis last. I looked at it first here. When I saw that, I went to validate it in the PPs, and I did. And that makes Serengeti Empress tough. Now, she did hold on to Covfefe last year, but those last two races, 86 and 82 Echo Bay speed figures, are 20 points below the contenders in this race. So even if she bounces back, I think she's paced. I don't think she's going to hit the board. At least that's how I'm betting the race. Now, with Latruska and her going at it, the question is Bellafina and Come Dancing and how they get. And they're good horses. Bellafina, of course, first in the Desert Stormer, second beaten 3/4 in the Great Lady M, both in California, of course. And she got 108 and 106 figures. I'll come back to why I think that's important, because it's just my reference points. Come Dancing, second in the Vagrancy. Now, the horse that won the Vagrancy is Victim of Love. And that was a flukish effort. She got a 108 figure, as good as Bellafina's best pretty much ever. She got a 110 and a 109 last year in the Breeders' Cup Filly Mare Sprint and the La Brea. And Come Dancing, about the same range. So Victim of Love ran a grade one quality race last time out. If that's not a fluke, she can do this, and she'll be in a good stalking position. My top pick, she's my second pick, she's 15-1. My top pick is Pink Sand, who is 10-1, who I can't believe is 10-1, because I completely draw a line through the fifths only because it's McGehee. You know, when you talk about trainers, Seth, and of course she was off January to June, but McGehee is going to bring her back in a grade one off of that horrible race. He wouldn't do that if she wasn't fine. And so I'm going to draw a line through that. You look at her race before that, the Inside Info, at 7 furlongs at Gulfstream with the other Ortiz. I ran riding today. And that was the race where she rallied from 12th. If this race goes in 44 and change early, which I think it will because of Latruska, Pink Sands is it. So this is a race for me that I love. I'm either going to go down in flames or hit it out of the box. I'm going to bet Pink Sands, the Victim of Love, to win. I'm going to bet them an exact as over themselves plus Bellafina and Come Dancing. I'm going to play a place bet as an exacta as a place bet of just Bellafina and Come Dancing over Pink Sands and Victim of Love. And I'm going to try and crush this one. I have a really strong opinion, as I think you know by now.
Yeah, and I don't really disagree with you. On pick bets, I'm going to use Serengeti Empress, but I have Bellafina and Pink Sands right underneath. So if the pace falls apart, I thought those were the two alternatives to be making the move in the lane. I had Dave Grenick from the Racing Forum on yesterday, and he made a little buzz for Pink Sands as well. So I'm not, you know, on the top, I have Serengeti Empress, you don't like. But then underneath, I like yours.
Let me add something that Dan Jordan pointed out last night on the webinar, is that Victim of Love's trained by Todd Beatty, who people know mostly as a, you know, a Laurel, Pennsylvania guy. But he trained a horse named Traver before it went to, I forget who it was. We showed the PPs yesterday, and that was a multiple. He hadn't won a graded stakes before the vagrancy in 6 years, but this guy can train.
Yeah, he's a kind of a Penn National guy, and as you say, he does float under the radar, but he's had some nice horses that have gone on to bigger circuits and done well. Don't have a replay for the Troy, just because I didn't know where to go in here. I'm going to be interested to see your thoughts. I wound up, you know, on the favorite, Empress, just, you know, has been off since last year, the Breeders' Cup Turf Sprint. But the workouts seem to indicate this one's okay. Pure Sensation, I'm not sure as a 9-year-old this horse is the same. I thought that horse was interesting. Sheki Shabazz on kind of the move backward on the move to the new barn. But I think with the 2-for-2 record over Saratoga, maybe the horse bounces back. Chewing Gum gets a class test in here. I think the whole field has races you can look at and think, oh, those look great, and has a lot of question marks surrounding them as well. So as I say, I'm going to be interested on your thoughts. What do you think of the Troy?
This is another go big or go home for me. I think all the favorites are suspect.
Yeah.
In for me, as you say, he's getting bet off running in the Breeders' Cup Turf Sprint in his big races last year. He won the Wolf Hill, who Sheki Shabazz finished third in recently. Even though those were okay, forget the Breeders' Cup Sprint, he was third in the Woodford at 7-5. He was fourth in the Turf Sprint at Kentucky Downs at 2-1. It's been a while since he's been in form. I just question him. The other issue is pace. American Sailor absolutely is a need-the-lead type. You look at those 14 wins, everyone on the lead. He's run as fast as 21 flat going these short sprints. Pure Sensation, as you said, not only is he a 9-year-old, but he's a need-the-lead type. His last 4 wins were all wire-to-wire. He gets the lead. He sometimes wins, sometimes doesn't. He's gone as fast as 20-4. These guys, just the irresistible object, the immovable force. I think this is a big pace meltdown. Sheki Shabazz and him for me. I'm taking a stand on form. I'm looking at the two outside horses only here, Chewing Gum and Pulsate. I'll start with Pulsate, because when you look at that allowance optional claimer at Belmont on July 5th, front run the Fed won by 1 3/4. Delaware was a nose in front of Chewing Gum, who was a nose in front of Pulsate. Why would Pulsate be 3 times the odds when he is inches short of Chewing Gum and inches short of second? They ran the same race. Manny Franco rode him well. Pulsate ran second in the Paradise Creek, really and third in the Allied France, the only time, Allied Forces, the only time that he ran stakes recently. And he's got 104, 102, and 100 figures. He's a mid to deep closer. Chewing Gum is a deep closer. Rosario rode him really well before that allowance optional claimer at Belmont at 6 furlongs. I think the 5.5 hits him right between the eyes. I like the 7 and 6 here. Same play as the ballerina. Win bets on both. Trifecta 7-6, 7-6 all, 7-6 all, 7-6. If one of the favorites gets in second, it doesn't pay as much. But I love these two price horses in the race. Seth.
Yeah, and I will say I have no argument taking a shot, because as I noted earlier, there are a lot of question marks about the entire field. So taking a shot is perfectly understandable. All right, finally, let's go out to Sunday, because I wanted some thoughts on the Ellis Park Derby. Again, like the Travers, this is going to play into the Kentucky Derby a month away. Nice full field they wound up with in here. Obviously, the horse to beat is going to be Art Collector. We watched that replay a little bit earlier, the Bluegrass. So for this one, I wanted to pull up a horse I thought was a little bit interesting. We'll watch the Ohio Derby. Dean Martini is going to be the number one horse. I will note, the horse that runs second, number 10, South Bend, runs in the Travers. So maybe we get a little barometer on Dean Martini with a Travers performance by South Bend. But as I say, I thought Dean Martini was a little bit interesting in the Ellis Park Derby. Art Collector, however, just seems like a brand new 3-year-old. What are your thoughts?
Yeah, I think in a non-COVID delayed Derby picture, Art Collector would have never made it. He didn't get his really big race until that race in May. And that's a good thing, actually, I think, to a later Derby, because you do get to see things you wouldn't normally see. He is the one to beat. And Shared Sense and your horse you mentioned, Dean Martini, have both won 9 furlong stakes. This is a really interesting race for me, and I actually love it. Again, I'm saying that the third time today on this show. This is the third race I really love. I like Art Collector, but I'm going to also like a horse named Little Menace, who is going to be underrated and underbet, and this is an interesting horse. So let me make his case. Little Menace sprinted. He was by Inch of Mischief out of Arch, so he really isn't bred to sprint. He sprinted his whole life, second, first, first, second in the Gazebo Stakes at Oak Lawn, fourth in the Bachelor. After 2 months off, Asmussen said, let's try him at two turns. Not only let's try him at two turns, he's eligible for first level, second level allowance. Let's put him in the Grand Prairie Derby. He battles head and head the entire way on slow fractions. I don't know how slow they are pace-wise because I don't know how the track's playing. And he wins by 3 1/4, drawing off after battling. He gets a 103 Echo Base figure. And the reason I'm going to mention that is now, the only other horse in the race that broke 100 in his last race at Art Collector was a 102 in the Bluegrass and 106 before that, when he won the mile 16th at Churchill. The only horse. Little Menace is making his second start off a layoff. He ran on the lead. He also came from off the pace. Doesn't wear blinkers, so I don't think he's an early type. Steve Asmussen, last 2 years, dirt routes, last out winner, running in the stakes off a 30 to 60 day layoff, has an 11% ROI positive, about 22% wins. This is the leading trainer in the country. He's got 11.5 million. This horse is the top trainer in the country, well-bred, the most expensive horse in the race, cost $460 at auction as a yearling in August at Fasig Tipton in 18. He's got the right figure. Santana's not here because he's riding in Saratoga. So he goes to Martin Garcia, who's just fine. They just don't use him much, Asmussen. And I think this horse is a gift at anything above 4 or 5 to 1, to be honest. So I'm playing Little Menace to win. I'll play it exactly like I do in this case of everybody over Little Menace. And I'm playing Tries, Art Collector, Little Menace, first and second with everybody in third, and first, third, everybody in second. I think this horse is, again, because he's so lightly raised, he comes in from Lone Star, all these other factors, he's being ignored here. But it's Asmussen. It's Into Mischief. It's a horse that just won a mile and a 16th, who was bred to get a mile and an eighth in spades. So he's the second best horse in this race, in my opinion.
I like it. So a little bit of a pop in the Ellis Park Derby. Ellis, as always, we appreciate the visit. Again, folks can find the feature race, the Travers, if they go to equibase.com, and you have other info around the internet as well.
Ellis Park Derby is a special second race of the week we put on our website, and I'm also doing daily race selections for Ellis Park at ellisparkracing.com. So my selection for Sunday will be the Ellis Park Derby. You can get this analysis in writing.
Very good. And I also, I'm rooting for you. I saw you're part of the little challenge they got going on out at Indiana kicking off this weekend.
Yeah, it's going to be tough because the people that are Indiana, Bill Downs, Nancy Eriholtis, and Rachel McLaughlin are Indiana pros. So I said I win on best hat, and we'll see where it goes from there.
Very good. Ellis, again, as always, appreciate the visit. We'll check in as the meet goes along as well.
Thanks, Seth. Thanks, everybody. Have a great day around the country.
Ellis Starr, National Racing Analyst for Equibase. We'll take another break, come back, and wrap things up for this edition of Racing Across America. Stay tuned.
Where's the best place to find your favorite teams, your favorite food, daily drink specials, and wagering on live horse racing? Legends Field Sports Bar, 711 Central Avenue, Albany. Get your game on day or night with 75 flat-screen TVs, tournament-style pool tables, a private banquet room, and live horse racing. So if someone asks you where's the best sports bar in the capital region, tell them Legends Field Sports Bar, inside the Clubhouse Racebook, 711 Central Avenue, Albany.
No matter where in the world you are, the excitement of wagering on horse racing is just a click away. You'll get live streaming, past performances, race replays, our virtual tote board, analysis and selections from professional handicappers, a simple, safe, and secure wagering platform, and best of all, you get track prices. CapitalOTBBet.com. Bet any place, anytime at CapitalOTBBet.com. And be sure to download our new mobile app from the iTunes Store or Google Play.
Thank you. I think what you guys are doing is awesome.
You're doing a great job. Keep that game rolling.
Seth, you do a great job too. So thank you, and I appreciate you having me on, and I appreciate watching your show every day.
Welcome back to Racing Across America. I brought in some tape, the Winner's Circle interviews of a couple of races already, these midweek races, because I mentioned it when we talked about what was a funny guy last week. The midweek races, the chances that some of these winners can get overlooked a little bit off of really nice performances and worth kind of tucking in your back pocket. And that was the case yesterday as well with the New York Stallion Series and Jolting Joe. New York Stallion Series, don't forget, it's the Stallion Series. So these races typically will attract New York breds. But, and I'm not sure the exact requirements or restrictions, but they don't have, I guess the sire maybe just has to be based in New York. Anyway, Jolting Joe yesterday was a Kentucky bred in a field of New York breds in the New York Stallion Series yesterday. Mile and a 16th on the grass. This was the Cab Calloway division. I thought Jolting Joe, interesting horse for Mike Maker. I thought the horse stood out in the field, though, but had four career starts, four second-place finishes, but career debut as a second-place finish behind Art Collector, the third start of the career, second-place finish behind King Guillermo. You will hear Mike Maker kind of refer to that. We were disappointed with the second-place finishes and then realized these were kind of salty races. Had to get laid up in November for a little bit, didn't come back until July, and ran a good second in the seasonal debut down at Ellis, and then they pointed to this $100,000 race with a maiden. Again, he'd run second four times. But as I said, having run second to Art Collector, King Guillermo, Kentucky bred against New York breds with some obvious talent, Jolting Joe, you got even money yesterday. I thought that was kind of a bonus. But Fresco took some action. Dream Bigger took some action. They were both in the mix at the top of the stretch. It wound up to be Jolting Joe, though, for Mike Maker. And Mike Maker's Turbo Drive ran second. So it was a Mike Maker exacta. He's just on fire at the meet. So we'll watch a little bit of the stretch run. And then just wanted to, again, just so these nice performances don't get overlooked, had the Winner's Circle comments from both trainer Mike Maker and jockey Tyler Gaffleone. Yesterday's stretch run, New York Stallion Series, Cab Calloway division.
Bigger. Jolting Joe on the outside, Fresco just in behind, and out in the middle of the course, it is Turbo Drive as they come down for the eighth pole. Here's Jolting Joe, Turbo Drive, Dream Bigger, late move here from Zip Along. It's Jolting Joe, and he's going to break his maiden in winning the Cab Calloway division of the Stallion Series.
You know, the horse ran an incredible race at Ellis Park. He seems to put some tough competition, and our high hopes for him today.
His numbers seem to be going in the right direction. I mean, you see that he's improving with every race.
Yes, he does. Some of the seconds we were disappointed with, but turns out they're pretty live races and we shouldn't have been disappointed.
It wasn't like he was hanging, it was just he was getting beat by a pretty good horse.
Correct.
More than that. What about distance wise? I think
he'll run out for a Mission Impossible. His gallop out in his last two races have been tremendous.
You made the seasonal debut down at Ellis. How long has this race been on your agenda?
Well, it's been on our agenda for a year. just thankful he was able to make it. He got injured in his last start at Gulfstream last year, and I thought he came back well.
Did the race kind of set up the way you thought it might?
I thought he was going to be up on the lead, but left it up to Tyler. He rode a great race as usual.
And the other horse that ran second, talk about him.
I think he was just outrun, maybe lost a little ground, but had a great race as well.
Running 1-2, gotta be pretty pleased.
Like it.
Obviously, he's done well against Open Company, and this is for the New York series. Where do you go next with him? You have any plans?
I don't know. It's two races close together, so I'll talk it over with the connections, go from there.
The short run into the first turn, I was planning on being a little more forwardly placed, so we didn't get away the cleanest. I looked to my inside and there's two going at it, so I figured I would just sit behind them, let them do the dirty work. He was traveling nicely throughout, and when I asked him for a run in the top lane, he gave me an extra punch.
I was going to say, how did he feel coming down the stretch when you were kind of eyeing those horses?
Like I said, as soon as that horse came up to him, he just kind of found a little bit more, but I still think there's more in the tank. We haven't seen the best of him yet, and hopefully he just keeps improving.
Yeah, so again, as I say, just don't want kind of a really nice performance to get overlooked, given that it's a Thursday afternoon. But Jolting Joe, that was career start number 5. Nice win. And they I think they have some options with this horse going forward. But another nice win also for Mike Maker, who's just on fire at the meet. All right, we'll wrap things up. But again, I want to remind you, did it yesterday. I want to do it again today to remind you of these three charities that have the events this week that are worth kind of playing into. Racetrack Chaplaincy, they had their virtual champions talk Wednesday night, but you can go to the Racetrack Chaplaincy website, rtcany.org, or as I say, type in New York Racetrack Chaplaincy into Google, but it's rtcany.org, and you can pull up the replay of the nice talk they had the other night. Terry Finley, Ramon Dominguez, Dale Romans, Tom Durkin, and then also make a donation to the chaplaincy. They were really out in the forefront of helping out the Backstretch workers with the Backstretch Employee Service Team and some of the other organizations. New York Thoroughbred Horsemen's Association was involved too, but really helped out with the situation during this whole pandemic period with Backstretch workers and the food pantry for the chaplaincy and whatnot. But again, see if you can kick in a couple of bucks to the chaplaincy. Belmont Child Care Association, they do great work. We had Humberto Chavez in the other day from the chaplaincy, but we also followed up with Michael Dubb and Libby Imperio from the Belmont Child Care Association. They have the great Anna House down at Belmont that helps take care of the kids of the Backstretch workers and provides them with some educational opportunities that for the little kids then lead into a head start as they move into public school. So they do great work there on the Backstretch. And when we talked with Michael Dubb the other morning, we had the photo of across the street. They're going to have a similar facility next season up here at Saratoga. So, again, they normally have a party up here every year that helps raise money. Obviously, with the situation, the party can't happen this year, but they have a virtual party this week. Today may be the last day, or no, I think it goes till Sunday. I'm in my head, I'm looking. I think it started Monday and goes through Sunday. So there's still a couple days left. But go to their website, belmontchildcare.org. Check out the virtual party situation and maybe toss them a donation as well. And our friends at the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation, they have their barbecue coming up on Tuesday. But today's the last day, and I think you have until noontime, so about another hour or so to pre-order barbecue from, you pick it up at the Saratoga Winery, just a mile outside of town. Nice venue there. But you pick it up on Tuesday. If you order today, and again, the orders will wrap up at noontime, and they were getting close to their limit, actually, but you may still have a chance to get in. They'll give you a time to come over on Tuesday. There'll be some VIP celebrity guests over there on Tuesday. Donna Brothers, Steve Bick, Ramon Dominguez, Tom Durkin, Pete Fornatel, J.K. Jonathan Kinchin, Maggie Wolfendale as well. They'll all be at the Saratoga Winery for the TRF barbecue, the virtual barbecue. Again, you order ahead, do it by noon today, go pick it up on Tuesday. Also, if you go to the TRF website, they're going to have some baskets that will be raffled off. I think you get, for $10, I think you get 10 tickets. But you can check out the baskets on the website. There was a wine basket. There was a basket that had gift cards for some restaurants in town, another gift basket from our friends at Impressions downtown, some great Saratoga swag, as it were, and more. So, again, go to the Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation website for that info, trfinc.org. But, again, you can type in Thoroughbred Retirement Foundation into Google. You'll find it as well. All right, don't forget, Bounty continues today, or returns today, as it were, on a Friday. Play the late pick five at Saratoga for your shot at all or part of the Bounty this afternoon. Should be a lot of fun. And don't forget to join us tomorrow at the Diamond Club at the Embassy Suites. Just about a block off of Broadway, you turn at the entrance to Congress Park and go about a block up. You will not miss it. The Embassy Suites, the Diamond Club. We will be there probably kicking off about noontime. It says one there, but first post tomorrow is noon. So we'll be over to kind of kick things off with the opener. That's tomorrow. The Diamond Club at the Embassy Suites with the bankroll. See if you can get on the bankroll team. We'll try to make you a little money during the afternoon. Should be a lot of fun. Travers Day, OTB Live on the road tomorrow at the Diamond Club at Embassy Suites. All right, I'm going to wrap it up for Racing Across America for this Friday. It was fun. Thanks to Randy Moss for joining us. Thanks to Ellis Starr. Hopefully we tossed out some ideas for tomorrow, the Travers Day card, and more. I had fun. Hopefully you did too. Don't forget tomorrow, programming note with the early post time here at Saratoga on Travers Day. Handicapper support kicks off at 8. Saturdays at the Spa with Brian Netto kicks off at 9, and you won't want to miss Netto's show. He's got a great guest lineup tomorrow, so keep that in mind, 9 o'clock tomorrow for Saturdays at the Spa. But as far as racing across America, I will wrap it up for this Friday morning. Again, the weather has turned a little bit. The rain has stopped. Looks like it's going to be a nice afternoon here at Saratoga. So enjoy the races. Cash some tickets. Tune back in tomorrow morning right here, 8 a.m., for the Handicapper's Report. We will see you then.
Racing Across America with Seth Merrow. Racing Across America has been brought to you by CapitalOTBBet.com, the premier online wagering site in New York State. CapitalOTBBet.com. Sign up today. The Leah Auto Group. To search their inventory, schedule a service appointment, or find a dealership near you, visit LeahCars.com. Leah Cars for life. And the new Capital OTB mobile app. Wager anytime, anywhere. Download it free from the iTunes Store or Google Play.